The earthquake in Morocco in September had a magnitude of 6.8, but an intensity of 9. So that's a very high intensity. But here you see that induced earthquakes and natural earthquakes in the Netherlands have about the same intensity, which is kind of worrying, of course, and I will explain why. Professor Morabi also, I think, very well illustrated that measuring earthquakes is of the utmost importance. If you don't measure the signals, it's hard to know where the earthquake appears, has appeared, and what the impact of an earthquake is. In the Netherlands, of course, we are in a fortunate situation that we can invest a lot in seismic instrumentation. So these are the seismic sensors we currently operate in the Netherlands. And you see a high density in the northeast of the country, and that's where the earthquakes due to gas extraction occur. In the south of the Netherlands, we have tectonic faults, two larger faults called the Pale Boundary Fault and the Veldries Fault, are a source of magnitude up to 6 earthquakes. The Roermond earthquake is a famous one in the Netherlands. It was felt in northern France, up to northern France, Czechia. In the UK, it had a magnitude of 5.8, intensity of 7. And we estimate the return period for these kind of earthquakes in that region between 50 and 100 years. Problem is, with a lot of the seismic catalogs in the world, that the instrumental catalogs, so that we really measure earthquakes, we only do seriously for about 100 years. But when you want to estimate what can happen in a certain region, like here or in the Netherlands or elsewhere in the world, you want to extend this instrumental period, because something which happens every 5,000 years, of course, isn't in the instrumental catalogs because we simply didn't measure. So one of the things we did in the Netherlands is what we call a paleo-seismological investigation, and that's looking at fault lines themselves, excavating the fault line, and see whether you can find evidence for past displacements. This is an area in the Netherlands where we did such an exercise, and the first thing you have to do is identify the fault. You can hardly see the fault in the field. So what we did, we applied geophysical techniques like ground penetrating radar, which is the lower frame, or electromagnetic measurements, which is the upper frame, to identify the fault. And there where it says F in the lower frame, that's where we saw that the fault who is responsible for the natural earthquakes in the Netherlands, where the fault is located. Next thing you do in a paleoseismological investigation is excavate the fault. So you dig a trench about 10-15 meters deep over the fault line in order to map past displacements along the fault. And on the right side you see the excavation of the fault, and on the left side you see a drawing of geologists who mapped the fault as it surfaces. This is a very intense exercise, of course. This lasts for months. But this is a way to get inside past displacements along a fault which aren't in any instrumental catalogs. What we found is that we could look back, and we did that with carbon dating, we could look back 16,000 years along the soil that was excavated, and found indications for two earthquakes which were larger than magnitude 6. They are estimated now around 7.5. So not an instrumental catalogs, but important if you want to assess earthquake hazard in a country to extend this period. One of the issues we found with these kind of studies is that you have to confirm the displacements that you found, and you see the drawing of the displacements. You have to confirm the displacements that you found in that specific trench laterally. You have to know the lateral extent of the displacement. Because as the professor just explained, you need to have an estimate of the fault plane and the stresses over that fault plane in order to estimate an earthquake magnitude. But this is one way to look back further than instruments can. For the Netherlands, again, moderate seismicity, so we have, this is an earthquake hazard map. We will come back to earthquake hazard in a few slides too. But this is the earthquake hazard, and that's, hazard is one part of the equation, risk is the other part. So you can have an enormous hazard in a region where nobody is living, then you have hardly any risk. You can have a moderate hazard with many people living there, you have a high risk. So hazard is only one part of the equation. You need to take into account the impact of this hazard and how vulnerable houses or people or whatever infrastructure is in order to translate this hazard to risk. Hazard is defined, as the professor also said, in terms of ground acceleration or ground velocity, which is a measure of the impact of the earthquake. And exactly these numbers that come out of these kind of hazard analyses can be taken by engineers in order to translate to building codes and adapt buildings in order to resist earthquakes. But as a seismologist, you would typically do the exercise up to the hazard calculation and then involve engineers, building engineers, in order to translate it to building codes and assess risks, etc. Again, the instrumental network in the Netherlands, as I said, we are in a luxurious position. Now I want to focus on the northeast of the Netherlands, where we have many stations, and that's because of the induced seismicity. Those are earthquakes due to gas extraction in the Netherlands. We have one of the largest onshore gas fields in the Netherlands. We have been extracting gas there since the 60s. In the 90s, suddenly, after 30 years, suddenly earthquakes start to appear. And very recently, the gas field was actually shut down. It was a major source of income in the Netherlands, but the government decided to leave the gas where it is and shut down the gas field because the risks and safety was becoming too bad. So here is the seismicity, again, small-sized earthquakes, but that specific region has seen since 1991 1600 earthquakes. Ranging in magnitude, well, what we can measure from magnitude 1 up to magnitude 3.6. But of course, in these gas reservoirs themselves, the earthquakes are so small that they measure minus 6, minus 7, minus 8 on the Richter scale. So those are minus magnitude, micro-size earthquakes. Let me continue. This is a cross-section of the gas field. So the vertical axis is 4 kilometers, so 4 kilometers depth. The horizontal axis is about 14 kilometers, so it's a huge gas field. And you see in the yellow layer, that's the gas reservoir, it's a sandstone. Above the gas reservoir is a very thick layer of salt. The salt keeps the gas in the reservoir. Well, what happens is you take gas out of the sandstone, it reduces the pressure in the sandstone, so it starts to compact, as it's called, because the overburden keeps pushing on that specific layer. The compaction is not the same everywhere in the field, so tension is built up along these faults and earthquakes occur. The gas layer itself is about, or the sandstone reservoir is about 100 meters depth, and the compaction now at depth after 50 years of gas exploration is 1 meter, which led to a surface lowering of the Earth's surface of 40 centimeters. The rest is absorbed by the medium and all these earthquakes. On the right side, I think it's what I want to show there. The red colors and blue colors are not so important, but there are many faults in the gas field. These are all faults limited to the gas field. As you could see in the previous picture, or on the left side, they don't reach the Earth's surface. But so there are many faults and many earthquakes can be generated. Why are we so worried about earthquakes? Well, we or were worried because they become less and less over the last couple of years as the gas, less and less gas is exploited. But they are shallow, one, they are only at 3 kilometers depth. That's an important thing, and it's a very weak soil. The Netherlands, as you may know, is a country. Netherlands means lowland, peiba. We are lower than the sea surface. So most of the soil in the Netherlands is clay, mud, peat, which is a very weak, weak soil. And it leads to a high amplification of seismic waves. So if you have a very strong soil, a sandy soil, or even if you have hard rock, this is much, much stronger and can better handle earthquake signals than soils with a lot of water content, like a mud or a clay or a peat. So the weak soils lead to amplification, and we reach quite considerable ground accelerations for these larger earthquakes. So there's many damages, houses have to be rebuilt, people have to move out of their houses, etc., etc. The reason that the government this year decided to shut down the gas field after years of struggling about it. The professor already told that measuring earthquakes is very important, and I think that's one of the things